Hey, John Somes from simpleprogrammer.com. So what's the favorite topic that everyone likes to ask about? You guessed it right, specialization. I've got another question about specialization here, since I'm always talking about specialization. But yeah, there's a lot of confusion around this topic. So this question comes from Jim, and Jim says, first off, congrats on all your recent successes and impressive growth. It's very encouraging. Well, thanks, Jim. And he says, I've been putting a lot of thought into your advice around specializing, and I have two questions for you. One, I'm interested in your perspective regarding the necessity to travel and specialization. I live in a decent-sized city in Columbus, Ohio, which is the 15th largest city in the U.S. The specialization possibilities I've come up with so far seem to be limiting to maintain work in one city. The more I think about it, the more it seems like consistent travel would be required for deep specialization. What is your take on this, generally speaking? So I'll answer this one first. So, you know, as far as traveling and specialization, if you're in a fairly decent-sized metro area, you're probably going to be able to specialize pretty far down in your career, and your specialization might not match up. You know, if you're looking to work for a company to get a job, you can be a specialist in an area, like a deep specialization, and that company may not be looking, quote, for that specialization, but you might match up somewhere else, and then they might want to hire you because you're a specialist in this area. So what I'm saying is you might not see a job description that goes all the way down to your level of niche, that they're not looking exactly for you specifically, but because you're in that general area and you are a specialist and you've built up a reputation and a name, they're going to hire you anyway, right? So you're not going to really have a problem, you know, as far as career-wise with being too specialized. You can always, you know, if someone's an expert at a very low level detail of, let's say mobile development, say Android, so you pick some very specific specialization like messaging or you know, communication in Android. If someone's looking for an Android developer, they're not going to say, oh, well, this guy's a specialist in communication or this low level thing or in list views, so I'm not going to hire him to do general Android development. They're probably going to see that as a benefit and say, well, if we use any kind of thing around messaging or whatever your specialty is, this guy, we've got the foremost expert in this area. So that's always going to be a good thing. Now, if you're freelancing, if you're being a consultant, it might be a little different, right? You're probably going to find more opportunities traveling around as you find people with specific pains, especially if you're the kind of, you do a specialization where you solve a specific pain that people have, right? Something that in their business that you have the exact solution for, and maybe you've done some kind of productized consulting there where you come in and let's say that you design corporate websites or you make corporate website messaging clear or testimonials, or you create a mobile version for, you know, a corporate website, something specific like that. You can go and find those people, and that's probably going to require some travel. You're probably not going to find enough people in your space if you're doing something like that. So it really depends on what you're doing. For the most part, though, you know, I would say that most people don't really have to worry about this. Like, there's very few specialties that I can think of where if you're in some kind of a major metro area where it's going to hurt you, you know, you might not be able to optimize it, right? You might, if you have the travel, if you're willing to travel, you're probably going to be able to do more with your specialty. So that, you know, takes care of that. And then number two, he says here, when I started my career in the 90s and early 2000s, independent consulting was prevalent. At some point, I noticed the majority of corporations starting to standardize a short list of approved vendors that can be used, and typically there are no exceptions, especially for independent consultants. Have you noticed a similar trend, and how do you circumvent this common limitation as an independent consultant? Thank you so much, and I hope to see your response on your blog. Well, how about a video? So this is what Jim is talking about here, is that sometimes, you know, big corporations will have like this list of approved vendors, and if you're not on that list, you can't do any consulting for them. And so, yes, this is true, this does happen, but it doesn't happen all that often, and it's quite possible to get on that list. Now, sometimes they have, you know, they look at Dun & Bradstreet and they say, okay, you have to be this big of a company, and you know, you have to have this many employees or whatever, or you've done this many $1 million of contracts, so there's no way that you're going to get into those. But don't bid for those jobs, right? You got to start somewhere, you know, look for the smaller things, especially if you're just a single person independent consultant. You don't need to go get HP or IBM as your client. Maybe you can, but that's probably going to come from a personal referral inside there anyway. And when that happens, they have certain ways of circumventing the rules, and they know their ways around their system. Even government agencies, you know, this is common. I've done some contracting and consulting for government agencies that had an approved list of vendors, and somehow I was magically allowed to participate. Now, what they did in that case was they just put me under one of their vendors, and I subcontracted out for that person. You know, essentially, I wasn't truly a subcontractor, but they made the books, or they made it look that way, right? They made the contracts in such a way so that I was, quote, a subcontractor. So there's ways around this. Most corporations could probably do the same thing. But in general, I wouldn't focus on those types of consulting gigs, because that's going to be difficult to get. Like, you know, if that opportunity presents itself, sure. But in general, there's enough small businesses. In fact, a majority of businesses in the United States are small businesses. Focus on them. They're not going to have an approved vendor list. It's going to be a lot easier for you to get in there and to do consulting. And there's a lot more. So I, you know, again, I wouldn't worry about this. There's definitely always going to be work for an independent consultant. There, you know, you might have to go and find your business. In fact, you will. So don't just look for the HPs and the IBMs and the Apples. Look for the small businesses, and you won't have a problem. So thanks for those two excellent questions, Jim. I think those are both really good questions here. And if you have a question for me, email me at john@simpleprogrammer.com. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Take care.